Kinsey graduated and went to teach at Indiana University. At a picnic, he met Clara Bracken McMiller, a chemistry student. They married in 1924 and had four children. Kinsey was bisexual. He himself had sex with other men. He and his wife agreed that each could have sex with other people, as well as with each other. Dr. Judith Reisman is an eminent professor, author, and the leading expert on Alfred Kinsey. She has served as associate professor at the University of Haifa in Israel and full professor at American University in Washington, D.C. She is currently director of the Institute for Media Education and director of the Child Protection Center at Liberty University School of Law. Dr. Reisman's unique research caused a re-examination of the very basis of Kinsey's work. It demonstrated his direct influence on America's sexual revolution. Some of Dr. Reisman's notable books include Kinsey, Crime and Consequences, and Kinsey, Sex and Fraud, The Indoctrination of a People. Dr. Reisman's studies show how Kinsey and his work sought to normalize in society his own personal deviant sexual habits.
When they married, immediately, he was involved in the sex research right away. And what a guy like that is called now, who marries, she was his beard, is what the homosexual movement refers to marrying somebody in order to maintain your position in society. And it would have been an absolute ruin for him if he would have been known to be homosexual.
By 1929, Kinsey had studied eugenics at the Bussey Institution. This led him to develop a deep relationship with Dr. Hermann Joseph Müller, a radical socialist and a colleague at Indiana University. Müller would receive a Rockefeller Foundation grant in 1932. It was for further study of eugenics at the Kaiser Wilhelm Brain Research Center in Berlin. In 1938, Kinsey suddenly chose to leave entomology and to teach a radically liberal course on marriage, family, and sexuality, dressed all the while in conservative suits and bow ties.
So he was teaching this course, and that gave him the excuse to say he was going to be collecting data. He was asking all kinds of very personal questions. He wanted to take their histories, their sexual histories, right? And he would ask the girls to measure their body parts because, he claimed, there was no data. Well, that was not true at all. There was plenty of data, plenty of reports out there. They weren't the kind that he wanted. So he made that claim. It was picked up and supported by the Rockefeller Foundation. So in order to understand what people were doing, we have to have a new science. The science would be the science of sexology, which did not exist. There was nothing like that.
Immediately, in the spirit of Sigmund Freud, he railed against the repression of sexual desires. He rejected the unity of science and religion, and thus of nature and nature's God. As a result, he rejected the reality of the two sexes being one flesh, made complementary, and thus the important science of male-female complementarity, that a woman is an XX chromosome karyotype and a man is an XY chromosome karyotype.
If all persons with any trace of homosexual history or those who are predominantly homosexual were eliminated from the population today, There is no reason for believing that the incidence of the homosexual in the next generation would be materially reduced. The homosexual has been a significant part of human sexual activity since the dawn of history, primarily because it is an expression of capacities that are basic in the human animal.
Kinsey's courses became immediately popular among the students. Soon after, Kinsey founded his Institute for Sex Research at Indiana University with grants from the Rockefeller Foundation and the National Research Council.
Why did the Rockefeller Foundation fund him? Kinsey was a nobody. He comes to them and he says, I'm interested in the same things you're interested in. And so they funded everything through this alleged interest in prostitution and VD.
Dr. Kinsey's team forced subjects to give the desired answers to their sex questions.
His team, good-looking young men, no women, no Jews, no blacks, no Catholics, nobody with any kind of religious, he had a terrible animus against Catholicism.
We are the recorders and reporters of facts, not the judges of the behaviors we describe. The only kinds of sexual dysfunctions are abstinence, celibacy, and delay of marriage.
So where did all these results come from?
They secretly trashed three-quarters of their research data. They based their claims not on a scientific sampling of normal males, but on a roughly 86% aberrant male population. One that included 200 sexual psychopaths, 1,400 sex offenders, and hundreds each of prisoners, male prostitutes, and promiscuous homosexuals.
And he said the prison population represents the public more than the middle-class student would. And women, oh my goodness. He called women who were living with a man for more than a year, the average married woman. A woman who lives with a man for more than a year, suddenly she's a married woman? That was his definition of a married woman. What woman, any woman, but certainly a married woman, would talk to a guy behind closed doors and tell him all about their sex lives, you know? So he made up what he wanted to make up. He made up anything that justified what he wanted to teach the American public was normal, was average, was without consequence, because he said no consequences to multiple partners, no consequences to bestiality, no consequences to any of these things. Do what thou wilt.
Kinsey's fake science and child abuse, how he solicited and encouraged pedophiles, and how they sexually violated from 317 to 2,035 infants and children in order to obtain his alleged data that normalized child sexuality.
Love is the answer, isn't it? But sex raises a lot of very interesting questions. There is a tendency to consider anything in human behavior that is unusual, not well known or not well understood, as neurotic, psychopathic, immature, perverse, or the expression of some sort of psychologic disturbance. Everybody's sin is nobody's sin, and everybody's crime is no crime at all.
Esther White was one of the subjects of Kinsey's fake science. She has suffered profoundly from being tragically molested as a child. The data that came from those horrific crimes committed against Esther was used in Table 34.
I lived in a little bitty town in Ohio. I had a little baby brother and a mother and father. I was a normal kid, except my life was different. It was like living two lives at the same time. It started at Indiana University. My grandfather went there to get his teaching certificates. And Alfred Kinsey was there at the same time, getting everybody in the school involved in his new project. Then my granddad took this teaching with him. So this was spread to the schools he taught at. Then my grandfather taught my father, and my uncle was right along with it. And he got the forms to fill out on all the things that they wanted to know. There was an underworld kind of thing going on that was a very secret world that I was to keep secret from my mother. Don't tell Mommy. You'll cause a divorce. When my father came to me and wanted me to do things that he said were secret, I kept them secret. I didn't understand sexuality even at that time. I knew real love. That's not love. My dad used a stopwatch. And he made home movies.
The world is not to be divided into sheep and goats. And not all things are black, nor all things white. The only unnatural act is that which you cannot perform.
Alfred Kinsey wanted to interview me. And so he came to my grandfather's house. This was probably in 1944. And I was born in 34, so that makes me 10 years old at the time. He was a big man. And he had two other big men with him. And one man had a clipboard, and he was taking down answers to my questions, and I was to answer them. I don't remember all the questions now. But one of them is, do you love your daddy? And I answered, yes. So before the men were ready to leave, my grandfather says to Alfred Kinsey, oh, what about the check? And he says, oh, I almost forgot. So he gets out this check for, I think, $6,000. In 1947, my dad gave me the pre-published copy of Alfred Kinsey's first book, and he wanted me to give a report to him, a couple of paragraphs on what I thought about the book. Well, when I saw the charts in there, I knew that that was what was going on.
I looked at Table 34 in Chapter 5. And children as young as 5 months of age in that table were being masturbated, raped. 24 hours around the clock, they were being used. What were they doing to that child? What were they doing? And he says, group number 3, weeping hysterically, especially among the younger children. Children fighting the partner. Partner? This is a man who is raping the child. fighting the partner to get away. To get away. That is what he called an orgasm.
My dad told me that he had worked with the author, and that the result of that, Alfred Kinsey would change the way the world recognized sexuality.
This was a strategy to normalize sexual deviance, to normalize his own sexual deviance and the sexual deviance of his comrades. Absolutely, this was a strategy, and it has been used since then to today. To today. The claim that children are sexual from birth.
Children are not sexual from birth. I can testify to that.
That is the strategy used to justify teaching kindergartners about sex, about sodomy, every kind of sodomy, calling it just another form of sex, to teach them about the gay, lesbian, and bisexual, and transgender, and undecided groups. And we don't want them to feel bad because we know that they are children. Since they're children, we know that they are sexual also from birth. So we've got to teach all of our children how to do all of these sexual things and reshape every little brain we possibly can.
No one ever thought about the fact that people would molest children and call it science. I'm sure many of those children, hundreds of children, probably committed suicide. That's profound. But looking back in time, that what I was put through was evil. The worst evil. I am so blessed to even be here. I have to forgive my dad because he was deceived by Kinsey.
Kinsey does Sexual Behavior of the Human Male. It gets a massive communications blitz across the nation. Everybody is hearing about it. Kinsey's telling us the truth about ourselves.
All of this was done with the complicit support of America's mainline media. Life, Look, and Time magazines promoted Kinsey's bold sex findings as heroic scientific truth.
Hugh Hefner, like most guys at that time, were virgins. They were saving themselves for their love, for their beloved, for when they were married, and he believed that. And when he was in college, he read Kinsey's book, Sexual Behavior in the Human Male. And he said, if Kinsey was the scientist, I will be his pamphleteer. And he was. He became his pamphleteer.
The American Statistical Association, in rejecting Kinsey's science, stated, critics are justified in their objections that many of the most interesting and provocative statements in the book are not based on the data presented therein. And it is not made clear to the reader on what evidence the statements are based. Further, the conclusions drawn from the data presented in the book are often stated in much too bold and confident a manner. Taken together, these objections amount to saying that much of the writing in the book falls below the level of good scientific writing. The noted statistician John Tukey condemned the sampling procedure, stating that a random selection of three people would have been better then the group of 300 chosen by Mr. Kinsey.
The head of the American Statistical Association sent a bunch of guys, Turkey and three guys, to the Kinsey Institute to talk to them about their data. First of all, Kinsey lied and he said he had a statistician. He never had a statistician.
Kinsey published Sexual Behavior in the Human Female in 1953. Though it didn't sell as well as his first book, it still became a bestseller.
Before Kinsey, you had three possibilities of law. One was natural law, biblical law, law by our experience, and then common law. And suddenly that would be replaced by scientific data, science law. What has been proven by science becomes our determination for what will be acceptable in a courtroom.
The Kinsey Institute's fake science and the American Law Institute's model penal code were both funded and quietly implemented by the Rockefeller Foundation, and would be funded further and quietly implemented throughout the world by another Rockefeller-funded project, the United Nations.
The causal effect of Kinsey's fraudulent criminal data. In 1955, the American Law Institute Model Penal Code is produced. It goes throughout the country. It's sent to every state, to all the legislators. And what that would do would eliminate what we had known to be as common law. As a result, it would eliminate much sex offense laws and allow for the parole of sex criminals. And you just give them a little therapy and give them another chance. So fornication and cohabitation would be the first laws that went the way of the dodo bird. But what it did in the long run, eventually, was to weaken or eliminate all of our laws on adultery. Seduction went out the window. Prostitution solicitation, tremendously weakened. Sodomy and bestiality, normal, harmless, weakened. Obscenity, exhibitionism, alienation of affection, breach of promise, those start to fall. Abortion, and from there, partial birth abortion. Euthanasia, cloning, fetal harvesting, all these things would suddenly require you to go into the court and say, I was physically harmed. There was real damage.
Just when you think you've gotten to their goalpost, you say, okay, so now you have marriage between one man and one woman. You good now? 20 years later, they change it again. They move it. So wait a second, I thought you supported the Defense of Marriage Act. It's now the goalpost isn't there, it's here. Well, that's right, we've evolved, we've changed. So they're always moving it all the time. They're constantly changing. And it's maddening. That's very frustrating. What is the end game?
So Playboy funded SECUS, Sex Education Council of the United States, and Mary Calderon, who ran SECUS, who had been the medical educator for Planned Parenthood. So SECUS was formed at the Kinsey Institute, with the idea that they would be in charge of sex education and teach in the schools. That formed the foundation for sexology, for the training of sexologists, for the training of sex therapists. How can you be teaching that based on the lies created by a sexual psychopath, a pederast, and identify that as a field of legitimate research, of legitimate influence, and they influence everything.
During the last 6 months of Kinsey's life, his health steadily declined as he gradually developed congestive heart failure. Then one day, walking in his garden, he tripped and fell, injuring his leg. The bruise developed into a deadly embolism. On August 25, 1956, Kinsey died at the hospital in Bloomington, Indiana. He was 62 years old. The Kinsey Institute steadfastly refuses to reveal Kinsey's sources and study methods. This, in and of itself, renders his scientific research utterly meaningless because it cannot be checked by examination and replication, because the primary principle of scientific research is that it is useless without verification or replication.
All of this moves to loosen our protective mechanisms for the mother and the child and for the family, and therefore destroying protection for the mother, the child, the family, destroys the civilization.
The mind is a very, very tricky and delicate thing and not to be messed with. So mind got messed with. And like many people who identify as a transgender person, I never had homosexual desires. I never had, quote, same-sex attraction. You know, it was just an issue of identity. It was an issue of affirmation. I ended up having a girlfriend in high school. I eventually became married, had two children. I worked on the Apollo space missions as an associate design engineer. I eventually became an automobile executive for American Honda Motor Company. But I still had this difficulty deep within me that I had not dealt with. So these are the things that I look back on 73 years later from the days of the purple dress. There's a word that was missing from the four-year-old and from my grandma at that time is a word called consequences. My grandmother was a seamstress, and she had a little business, cottage business, I'd say, running out of her house where she made women's clothes. My dad and mom would drop me off on the weekend quite frequently, and they would go fishing and camping. And so I was always curious about Grandma making all these clothes. And so there was not much for me to do. Her house was behind a junkyard of old cars. And so there wasn't any much play area. So I just stayed in the house and kind of watched her and became very curious about the clothes. And the more curiosity I had, the more she became interested in my curiosity. And so Grandma decided to make me a purple chiffon evening dress at the age of four out of curiosity. And so she affirmed me and encouraged me and loved on me, and that became a symbol in my head about my identity. She wasn't giving me the same affirmation as a little boy that liked to wear cowboy boots, that had ripped blue jeans, that was frequently dirty, and my t-shirts were rather torn and sloppy. And I kind of liked being that way, but in that purple dress, I was quite perfect, quite clean, and that's the way Grandma liked me. So there was a tremendous contrast between the boy and the girl. Well, that became, as Grandma put it, our little secret. And so after about 2.5 years, I took the dress home, and thinking that my parents wouldn't find it, well, my mother found it. And so we had a private little meeting around the dinner table one night with my brother gone, and she asked me where the dress came from, and I told her that Grandma made it. Well, she knew that it was her mother, and so that started this world war within the house between my dad and my mom. And my dad, who was a part-time police officer and industrial goods salesman, was less than thrilled. I mean, he was livid. And so Dad decided he was going to use heavy discipline, which was a hardwood floor plank across my bare butt, to discipline me, to sort of shape me and mold me into a strong guy. It probably did more to break me down than anything. It was demoralizing. It was painful. Even though the dress, I never saw it again, it couldn't go out of my mind. It was planted. It was embedded. It was there. I would go around and steal women's clothes and go hide them in the garage so my parents wouldn't see them, as a way to try to get back to feeling that affirmation that Grandma gave me. I longed for that. Dad's adopted teenage brother, Fred, a troubled young kid. Well, when Fred learned that I had worn a purple dress, Fred decided that he was going to tease and taunt me and make fun of me about wearing a dress. It was pretty normal for a teenage kid to make fun of an 8 or 9 year old. But it escalated, and it escalated to where he molested me. By the time I was a young teen, I'd taken on a name, Crystal, as a way to self-identify as that person in the purple dress, because it was like a radio playing in my head every day of my life that if I was going to be affirmed and loved on, I had to be wearing that purple dress, or I had to be a girl. And I became convinced over a period of time that maybe I should have been a girl. I would have been better off. Uncle Fred wouldn't have molested me. Maybe Dad wouldn't have hit me with a hardwood floor plank, and I wouldn't have needed to cross-dress, because I would have been all right out of the gate as a girl.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
I, Ronald Reagan, do solemnly swear
that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
That I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
And will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend.
Preserve, protect, and defend.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
So help you God.
So help me God.
Now, this was 1981, I'm nearly 40 years old. So I've been struggling or dealing or thinking or contemplating these things now for 36 years. I went to what they call a gender specialist. And Dr. Walker was the founder, the writer, the expert on gender identity issues. And when I went to him, he diagnosed me with gender identity disorder, because they hadn't come up with gender dysphoria yet. So he said, what you need is you need hormone therapy and gender reassignment surgery to resolve the purple dress, the hardwood floor plank, and all the other things that have transpired. And I went back and told my wife what the doctor had said, and we decided to fight it through prayer, but it didn't help. I didn't know exactly what I was dealing with. And so my wife and I decided to get divorced, which we did in late 1982, early 83. And in April of 1983, I underwent gender reassignment surgery at the skilled hands of Dr. Biber, who had, by the time he did my surgery, had already done some 3,000 surgeries. At At the end of the surgical procedure, they changed my birth record and my identity to Laura Jensen, female. You would think then, with all of this history, now at the age of 42, this whole purple dress issue would be resolved, that I would be complete and everybody's talking about this is what you need to do if you're going to be whole and happy. And this was the answer, right? And I decided to study psychology because I wanted to become a counselor and help people deal with these issues. Because I realized I needed more understanding. I needed more help myself. At UC Santa Cruz, and I started opening up those wonderful textbooks that are this thick, and I thought, gee, can I find anything in the pages of these books? And I remember coming across this Cornell University case study. The young individual had lost his mother. His mother had passed away, and he was very close to his mother. And what they decided was the young boy took on his mother's identity as a way to feel close to her. So if he became the female, then he felt like his mother wasn't gone. And I thought, that is not only interesting, it's rather bizarre that our mind could actually, you know, drive us to a different identity as a way to feel close to somebody who really wasn't there, because it's not reality, is it? There's no reality in taking on the identity of somebody who's gone. And so you begin to realize that the people who deal with these cross-gender identity issues are struggling with an inability to deal with reality. And so we take on an identity that isn't real. We make up this identity. Laura Jensen, it was not who I was, although it said on my birth record that I was a female, Laura Jensen. The state had made that possible. The surgeons had done the surgery to the point of being able to change your gender marker on your birth record, started at 4 years old with a simple purple dress. And so I began to look deeper into these issues of psychology and realize there's all kinds of things that people deal with: a body dysmorphic disorder, dissociative disorders, bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, and no one's talking about it. They're all looking at people and saying, well, just affirm them and help them change genders. Well, wait a minute. What about the comorbid disorders that are driving them to become someone else to resolve this conflict that lies deep within them? We're doing superficial changes to someone to try to resolve things that are so deep, so painful, so hurtful. But there's one thing that is absolutely crystal clear, and that is the consequences. If in fact we can change and destroy gender identity, if in fact that can be accomplished, then we have destroyed the foundation of the biblical family, one man, one woman. And that, I believe, is ultimately what many of the people who are promoting this ideology really want to do, is to destroy the foundation of Jesus Christ, marriage and family.
If anyone today thinks that the imposition of this LGBT transgender ideology is any less a profound distortion of what it means to be a human being than were the Nuremberg laws in 1935, they're kidding themselves. They're kidding themselves.
Father Philip Bachansky is Executive Director of Courage and End Courage International. a Catholic apostolate that offers support for those who experience same-sex attractions and their loved ones.
In the late 1970s, Cardinal Terence Cook was Archbishop of New York and created a new office in his Archdiocesan administration, trying to address the needs of the peripheries of the church. One of the things that Cardinal Cook wanted to take particular interest in was the community of Catholics who were experiencing same-sex attractions, living in homosexual relationships or engaged in homosexual intimate acts, and who were coming to Cardinal Cook. He was meeting them in the confessional or in his office and saying, you know, we've been living this way, but we feel a call to do something different, to embrace what the Church has to teach about chastity. But we're not sure we can do it on our own. We need help. We need the support of the Church. Father Benedict Grischel, who was assisting the Archdiocese in many ways even back then, and Father Grischel knew an oblate priest of St. Francis de Sales called Father John Harvey. Father Harvey had studied and written for several years about moral theology, and particularly about human sexuality and the question of homosexuality, and had been giving retreats for priests who were experiencing same-sex attraction and striving to live chastely according to their promise of celibacy. So our first meeting of what would become the Courage Apostolate happened on September 26, 1980. So from that first small meeting in New York, we now have nearly 200 chapters in 15 countries. And I don't know if that first group could have envisioned where we stand today, but certainly we feel that we've inherited a great legacy from them. What every human being is called to do is to pursue the virtue of chastity. Chastity is not repression. It doesn't mean pretending that we don't have desires. Chastity is integration. It means I consider my desires in light of my identity as a child of God, in light of my vocation, and I only act on those desires that are going to get me closer to being a saint, to living as a disciple, to living a holy life.
Father Paul Sullins is research professor of sociology at Catholic University of America and senior research associate of the Ruth Institute. Formerly Episcopalian, Father Sullins is a married Catholic priest with three children.
The brain differences between a man and a woman go all the way down. It's not just that gender is somehow a social expression. The social scientists are, while they're pursuing that agenda, the hard scientists are showing us that you can take the brains of two persons. You can't tell whether they're black or white. You can't tell what language they speak. You can't tell a lot of social things about them. But one thing you can tell is whether it's a man or a woman, a male brain or a female brain. And those differences are profound and persistent through all of our being, all of our life.
Kinsey's work of mainstreaming homosexuality and sexual perversion has damaged the Catholic priesthood and catapulted the Church into the worst abuse crisis in its history. It has already been shown that Bella Dodd, the former American communist, confessed to her friends, Drs. Dietrich and Alice von Hildebrand, of her success in recruiting over 1,100 men to the priesthood in the 1930s. But in an exclusive interview, Alice clarified that Bella told her that these men were not just communists, but homosexuals.
The communists are very clever. And he knew perfectly well that in order to destroy Catholicism, what they destroyed was to pervert priests. And so she says that there were seminaries, I think that in Poland, who were trained to spread homosexuality among priests. And she collaborated. She was truly very, very active, precisely. And she told me about this here. And she succeeded.
The case of Mr. Theodore McCarrick, demands a thorough report as to how such a man, with his sexual abuse history, could have risen to such positions of power in the church.